So thank you, Bluestockings, for hosting, and thank you everyone for being here. And as you may have noticed, our speaker list has grown since we originally started. So Bisi and Gaya are here, Ileana is here, and then we have two of Ileana's students. She's a high school teacher. So we have StellaRose Cajon here, and then Shana Fletcher. And then we are so lucky that an activist from the Bahamas is in town, Alicia Wallace. And then we also have someone from Girls for Gender Equity here, Brittany Brathwaite. And you told me, and then I have too much going on. Brathwaite.
Yep.
Thank you. From Girls for Gender Equity. So we'll sort of be rotating around throughout the hour, and then we'll have about 30 minutes for Q&A.
Oh, no, I just wanted to...
So 5 years ago, I was here in Bluestockings for a book event for my first book. And at that time, there were groups working on street harassment like Girls for Gender Equity, but globally, there weren't that many groups. And over the last 5 years, activism has really exploded in wonderful ways. And that's what my new book is about, really. What has been happening over these last 5 years, and how are international groups like the United Nations and governments and individuals like those in the room, what are they doing about this issue? So I feel like it's a really exciting time, and I'm so happy to be back at Bluestockings to be sort of documenting what's happening and celebrating it. So just quickly, so that we're all on the same page about the topic, to define street harassment, my organization, Stop Street Harassment, defines it as unwanted words, comments, and actions that are forced on a stranger in a public space without their consent. And it's directed at them because of their perceived or actual sex, gender, sexual orientation, or gender expression. And of course, people may also be targeted because of racial identity, religion, national origin, class, socioeconomic status. And some people are harassed for multiple reasons in one incident. Last night I was in Boston facilitating a focus group with Asian American women, and most of them, and many women, other women of color, talk about having both racialized and sexualized street harassment happening. Street harassment can really vary from perfectly legal acts like leering and whistling and catcalls, and sexist, homophobic, transphobic slurs, demands for a smile or sexual favors, to illegal acts like flashing, following, public masturbation, and sexual assault. So it really does range. And ultimately, street harassment is about power and control, and it's a manifestation of existing inequalities in our society, be that racism, sexism, or homophobia. Just a quick show of hands if people feel comfortable. If you have experienced or witnessed street harassment in your life that you know of. So we know it's a big problem. So one thing that has changed in the last 5 years is that there's a lot more documentation of this problem. It's not just us raising our hands and saying that we're experiencing it. There are a lot more studies that are being conducted. Just in the last 5 years, there have been studies conducted in places like Australia, Chile, Saudi Arabia, France, India, and Egypt. Here in the US, last year, my nonprofit commissioned the first nationally representative survey on street harassment in the US. And it found that 2/3 of women and 1/4 of men had experienced street harassment. For women, it was most often sexualized comments and touching. For men, it was most often homophobic or transphobic slurs. And what really upsets me the most is how young this issue begins. About half of the people surveyed who had been harassed said that it began before they were age 17. And we know anecdotally, especially in cities like New York, where young people are often in public by themselves, it can begin even younger, often around puberty, ages 9, 10, 11. And the part that upsets me really the most is how often it's adult men who are harassing both girls and boys, and it's predatory, and it's a form of pedophilia. And I think that if people could think about it in those terms and understand that, they'd be less likely to dismiss it or see it as a compliment or no big deal. So I personally have experienced hundreds, if not thousands, of street harassment incidences. Most often it's men whizzing by in their cars, whistling, honking, or hooting and hollering at me. But I've also had some really upsetting and scary experiences, being followed, being chased, being grabbed, men making sexually explicit comments. My most recent upsetting experience was in August. My partner of 12 and a half years and I eloped to Las Vegas, cliche, and got married. And within an hour, I was harassed in a grocery store parking lot. And two men told me that I looked beautiful and then immediately escalated into sexually explicit comments about my body. So on this day that was supposed to be happy and special, I felt really humiliated and disgusting. And you know, that's so often what street harassment boils down to, is it's not a compliment. They are trying to make you feel bad, or they don't even care how you're feeling. I have yet to meet a woman who does not have her own arsenal of street harassment stories. And I know many men who have them as well. And so my co-panelists who are up here are each going to share one story.
My name is Shana Fletcher, and I'm Ileana's student. And this is a piece that I shared in the International Day of the Girl Assembly at our high school. So it goes, "Smile, baby. Miss. Miss. Yo, I'm talking to you. Damn, mommy, you sexy. Can I have some? Who do you think you're ignoring? These are not compliments. I cannot walk to the store without being yelled at, without being targeted. Since I was 11, men have been in my face, terrorizing me in the street. I can't say anything back because I don't want to get spit on, or worse, physically hurt or killed. Even sadder, when I tell my family what I go through every day, their response is always the same. Well, what were you wearing? Never ask a woman that. It doesn't matter. I wear what I want for myself and my confidence, not to get street harassed or touched by a stranger's hand. I'm not asking for it." So, when I was 11, I was walking down the stairs with my dad, and he was behind me, and when I was walking down the stairs, this guy grabbed my leg, like, really close to my crotch, and that day we reported it to the police, but the police failed. They couldn't find the guy, and they just didn't really care about my story. So from then on, it was kind of built in me, like, street harassment is very, like, crazy, and then every day I've been street harassed, and it's an important issue. Yeah.
Thank you.
Hi, just a reminder, I'm Alicia, and I'm from a very small country of 400,000 people, and within that country, I'm from a very small island that's 21 by 7 miles. And unfortunately, I don't ever get to be in public space on my own island without feeling like prey, or feeling like I'm always at risk of something. And I have lots of really horrible experiences that I can share with you, but I won't do that. I prefer to talk about one particular day when I was just on this continuum of street harassment. I had had a really bad day, and for me, when I have a bad day, there are some things that I want, and that day I was like, I just want a Coca-Cola. That's it, that's all I want. And the car was down, so I had to walk, and it's fine because the store is like 5 minutes away. And I live in just this little subdivision that has probably less than 50 houses in it. And all of this that I'm telling you about happened before I got to the main road out of my own subdivision. Two men were walking toward me, and as I'm accustomed to doing, when I saw them coming towards me, I sort of took stock, checked it out, and decided, how am I going to respond if these people approach me? And they ended up commenting on my body and saying what they'd like to do to me and all these different things, but I'd already decided that I'm just going to keep walking and pretend like I didn't hear anything and just ignore it, because it had already been such a bad day. I really didn't want to escalate anything. So I got about 10 feet away from them when a little boy, definitely under the age of 12, looked at me and said, "Damn!" And I was horrified that this was coming from such a young boy. And I felt like I was trapped in one of those movies in the 80s, you know, when everything sort of slows down and the guy's kind of like, and he was washing a car and he had a rag in his hand and the car's here. And he's like this with the rag in his hand, like mid wax on, wax off kind of thing, just staring at me as I walked by. And I could feel it on my back as I exited the subdivision. So that's four people so far, right? So I get to the main road and I'm like, God, okay, I just need to cross the street and then I'll be at the store. As I was crossing the street, I don't know what these guys were doing to try to get my attention in the car, because by then I had already kind of blocked everything out. But I heard him honking his horn at me like a maniac and then yelled out, hey, so you don't say hi to good-looking fellas, eh? And I kind of just ran across the street and got into the store, and I found myself at the back of the store just standing there to catch myself, because it had been 5 minutes and I had been harassed by six people, one under the age of 12.
My name is StellaRose. I'm one of Ileana's students. This is a piece that I read to my school for the IDG assembly, and it happened about 2 years ago. So, it was a regular morning, and I was on my way to school. I was running late, so I decided to take a cab that was waiting in front of the hotel across the street from my apartment. I quickly ran across the street to get the cab. The loud music in my headphones suddenly disappeared as my earbuds fell out. I opened the door and abruptly sat down, slamming the door shut behind me. I robotically started to tell the cab driver the address of my school and how I wanted to get there. As I started to put the earbuds back into my ears, I noticed that the cab driver was looking at me through the rearview mirror. I glanced at him for a quick second and then brought my attention back to the phone to change the song I was listening to. As we slowly inched forward in heavy traffic on the West Side Highway, I could feel him staring at me. I slowly looked up at the mirror again to find him still looking at me, but this time with a large grin on his face. I uncomfortably sat, smiled back, and then hesitantly looked out the window to break the gaze. He then started to ask me personal questions about my life and self. He said, how old are you? What school do you go to? I must have gotten lucky this morning to have picked up such a beautiful girl. With each word that came out of his mouth, I felt more and more uneasy. He then asked me if I had a boyfriend. I nervously responded with a yes, thinking it would make him back off, even though I didn't have one. He started to describe what he thought my boyfriend would look like and how he would act with me. Then under his breath, I heard him ask, so, how's the sex? Is it big? Does he please you? As he continued to ask me these disturbing questions, I didn't seem to know how to respond, yet I felt obligated to give him a response and talk to him. Obligated to laugh and to smile at him and make sure he didn't think I was rude or obnoxious. As the cab went silent, my heart started to beat fast in my chest and I nervously fidgeted with the rings on my finger. My eyes darted around the cab as I desperately wanted to get to school faster. I could feel his glare on my skin and the breath from his voice near my face despite the glass between us. It felt like the only protection I had. When I saw the school's red flag ahead of us, a sense of relief surged through my body. I quickly paid for the cab and got out, but even as I walked away, I could feel him. His words played repeatedly in my mind, and I was unable to turn it off. That day at school went normal, and I seemed to block out the morning in the cab. When I got home later that evening, thoughts of the morning started to come back to me. I didn't say anything at first to anyone at home because I didn't think it was that big of a deal. I knew it was wrong, but I didn't realize the danger of the situation. My mother started to ask me about my day, and I nonchalantly mentioned the morning incident. As I started to explain what had happened and went into more detail, I felt overwhelmed with emotion that I had never felt before. We ended up reporting the incident to TLC, and I had to email my testimony to their lawyer. When they did a background check on the driver, he had a series of similar complaints against him that were never charged. I couldn't help but feel bad for the man or worried that what I had done may have been wrong, even though what he had done to women and girls, including myself, was inexcusable. A few months later went by and it happened again with another young girl. His license was then revoked.
Hello, I'm Gaya. Or it's actually Gaya, but people have a very hard time with the book here. So you can say Gaya. I'm from the Netherlands, but I immigrated to the US over a year ago. And my incident is, I think, not as harsh as some of yours. And I think that's because the Netherlands is probably not the worst country in the world when it comes to street harassment, but we do have it. And my impression is that it's getting worse. And now we'll get back to that, and we'll come back to that later. So my incident, of course, I do have a lot of incidents to mention as well. I know a few women, actually, that do not have an arsenal. I have spoken to a minority of women, and so that shows you that the Netherlands is not as bad as some others. A minority of women have never had a story of street harassment. But the majority has, and I have one too. I was on my bike, because it's the Netherlands. I was cycling next to a guy because he was going really slow. And he said, hello, hello, can you smile back to me? And I said, no, leave me alone, shut up. Because, you know, when you get older, you find it less important what others think of you, and you definitely find it less important to be nice to men. But the reason I tell this is because he immediately got very aggressive, and he sped up. He was going very slow before that, but he could cycle fast, and he caught up with me, and he started screaming at me instantly. And he said, "Who do you think you are? Who do you think you are?" And I didn't want to give him that gratification of demeaning me, because that's what it always is. You know, it's never about me. It's not a compliment. It's about him. And I didn't want to have him to feel like that. So I challenged him more, and I said, "I'm not impressed with you. I'm not threatened. Fuck off." Then he got even more angry, and I did get a little bit scared at that point, because he wasn't really coming at me. But luckily there was, but I stood still, because he caught up to me, and then he put his bike in front of me. So I stood still, and I said, "I'm not impressed with you," but I was a little bit scared. So he came towards me, but luckily there was somebody else who came, another man, who kind of tried to defuse the situation, which is very interesting, I think. He didn't say, "Leave her alone. What are you doing?" He said, kind of tried to go in between us, and he tried to distract him and with his talk. So he was very socially apt in that sense. So in the end, he kept talking to the guy, and he said, you cycle along." So I thought, okay, I'll do that, because I was late for a meeting. But the reason I bring this up is for two reasons. The first is to illustrate how it's not a compliment, because as soon as you don't give the submissive reaction and just take it, they instantly switch to a very aggressive state, because you're not playing your part. So, and that's why I want to share this story, where you see that it's never a compliment. You know, you hear people say, "Yeah, but you know, he's just telling you to smile. He wants you to have a nice day. This guy did not want me to have a good day." And the second is that I noticed that the guy who came in between, he tried to defuse the situation, but he didn't. He didn't really stand up for me. And even when I afterwards told my boyfriend, the first thing he said was, "Why did you talk back to him?" And I understand that, because he doesn't want anything happening to me, right? But the question should not be, why is she talking back to him? The question should be, why are these idiots behaving like this? Why is nobody, why are not more people talking back to them? So that was it. Thank you.
Well, my story is actually, you know, that point of intersectionality that most times we don't see. So I am a black man who is gay. And within the gay community, my body is fetish, is an aspiration for gay men, and mostly white gay men, of what I look like underneath my clothes, and the fulfillment of their desire. So funny, you know, Gaya, my story happened in Amsterdam, actually. And the story I will be talking about, and it was at the Amsterdam Pride. But before then, the reason why I'm choosing this story is also to illustrate the whole idea of compliment and the confusion that I had then, that, and now that so many of my friends are still having around street harassment, which kind of, in a way, challenges our masculinity. Because in a way, how do you explain a man experiencing street harassment? Which most times doesn't really happen quite often, but it happens a lot when you talk to men. And also because men are not really expected to talk about those things, because then it shows that you're weak, and for you to not appreciate that. And like I said earlier, for being a black gay man, it's even challenging the stethoscope for me to not appreciate my body being appreciated by somebody who has a racial power over me. And so there are all those complications. So it was at Amsterdam Pride, and I was there with my friends, and we were having so much fun. And I remembered it got really crowded, and we were working our ways through the crowd. And there was this guy who was removed, this very big, muscular guy who was removed his shirt, because then it was warm, and gay men were almost naked and walking around. And I was just walking down, and he looked into my eyes and said, "Tell me you don't like that." And I pushed him away. I was going to get very physical with him. And my friends held me back. And one of his friends said, "Don't mind him. Those N people, they always pretend as if they don't like it, but they know that they like it. Have you got a big one?" And I got really, really, really upset. And this started a conversation between my friends and I around, you know, they don't understand. They are angry about what happened, but they couldn't translate it to the fact that I should take it the way I was taking it, and I should interpret it the way I was interpreting it. But the lasting effect that he had on me, because it wasn't just a one-off incident, and which is some things I've experienced also growing up in Nigeria, where I had to check in my head the difference between street harassment and homophobia. And while if I walk down the street and people throw stones or call me names, are they being homophobic or is it street harassment? But the unintended consequences of that is I cannot go into a crowded place. And I developed that over time, and you will never see me in a place. I don't go to film festival, I don't go to protests, I don't go to anywhere where there are so many people, because the moment I get there, I became unnecessarily conscious and protective of myself. And that is how much it's not just destroying me, but it's destroying so many men who are afraid to talk about it because it will be seen as being weak. And I know that we'll talk about this more.
Thank you so much, everyone, for sharing your stories. And I think it's so important to hear each other's stories, to learn ways that our experiences may be similar and different. And so one of the chapters in my book includes some of the recent studies, and then also essays from people all over the world talking about how their experiences with street harassment may vary because of where they're from or their identity. And I purposely put the statistics and stories together in a chapter because that's really how a lot of policies are made, having the stories that compel people and the data that proves that it's a problem. Another chapter that I have covers why it matters. Why does this issue matter? And we've heard nuggets of it through everyone's stories, but there's four main reasons I came up with. One is that it falls along the spectrum of gender violence. Two, it could escalate without warning. You never know when a verbal harassment or someone following you may turn physical. And there have been people who have been murdered as escalation has increased that high. Three, is that it can have an emotional toll. And there are studies that show that lots of street harassment can actually really be traumatic for people. And then four, it limits our mobility in public spaces. It can dictate where and when we go, with whom, what we do, what we wear. It can influence our habits and our hobbies and our routes and our routines. And it is a human rights violation because in essence what it does is it makes our world get smaller and smaller and smaller because we feel like there's fewer places we could go. In another chapter I talk about how this is not a new problem. There are growing scholarship around street harassment in history, including two books that look at it from the 1880s to early 1900s, including many newspaper articles from New York City during that time period, focused specifically on women who were being harassed in much the same way as they are today, but they were also being resilient and fighting back. They were learning self-defense, reporting it to the police, using their hat pins to poke back at harassers. If we fast forward to the late 1990s, local women here in this area began meeting weekly in Bluestockings to talk about street harassment. And they became the Street Harassment Project. And they held rallies and events and demonstrations offline. And to their knowledge and my knowledge, they're the first group who began collecting stories online in 2000. So that's pretty cool. And so one of the themes that I talk about in my book is, what's the difference between before, when this issue was a problem, and now? And I really think it boils down to the internet, and specifically social media, because social media platforms allow us to put our stories out there every day if we so choose, to our family, to our community, to the world. And it allows us to be more relentless in keeping this issue fresh and present, and we're not letting it go away. It also allows groups around the world to collaborate together, to connect, to learn from each other. And social media also is really helping educate people. Did people see or hear about the viral video last year, 10 hours of walking in New York City as a woman? Yeah, so there were many problems with that. That could be a whole other discussion. But one of the positive outcomes was that there's so much more awareness. I speak all over the country, and rarely do I encounter anyone now who doesn't know the term street harassment. And a few years ago, I was always having to explain it. So that's a significant change. So I do talk a bit about social media and activism, and I have two case studies specifically around this. One is in India after the 2012 Delhi gang rape, and the other one is in Egypt during the couple of years of revolution and all of the mass sexual assaults against women at Tahrir Square. And so I talk about how people use social media to organize on the ground and also to let the world know what was happening. So overall, I feel like this is an exciting time because so much is happening and changing, and we are seeing such significant and important changes. So just to name a couple before I turn it back over to my co-presenters. There are several international entities that have taken on this issue, such as UN Women. They have a Global Safe Cities Initiative, and it launched 5 years ago. And they're in 22 cities now, doing comprehensive 5-year plans, specifically around gender-based violence in public spaces. And just as one example of an outcome, Port Moresby in Papua New Guinea was one of their pilot sites, and they've been really successful at doing a lot of work to make their marketplaces, where everyone shops, and one of the main ways that women have a source of income. They've been working to make them safer and free from harassment. There are more governments who are taking action now. I mean, a few years ago, governments would not think twice about this issue. They would see it as a compliment or no big deal. But there are many taking action. So here's three quick examples. So in France this year, the French government did a study on sexual harassment on public transit. And 100% of women said that they'd experienced harassment there. So as a direct result, the French government is gearing up to do a nationwide anti-harassment transit campaign, which is huge. Peru, there's an activist group there that did a national study. They've been doing online and offline activism. And for about a year, they lobbied and then worked with the Peruvian government to pass a law against street harassment. And that did pass in March of this year. And there are countries like Chile, Argentina, and Panama who are now considering laws too. And as a side note, I know that laws are not the end all be all, and there can be a lot of problems with them, and so I also address that in the book. And then here in New York City, City Council Member Julissa Ferraris organized and held the first ever City Council hearing on street harassment 5 years ago. And that made international waves and really helped bring legitimacy to the issue in a way that there hadn't been before. And in the 5 years since then, she's been really an advocate within the City Council, helping with events, giving funding to groups here. So it's been really, really great. So one of my favorite sections of the book, or it's actually two chapters, and it focuses on what individuals are doing. Individuals like you and me and everyone up here with me who just was sick of this, sick of street harassment and wanted to do something, wanted to take a stand. And so I have one chapter focused on offline actions, so marches, rallies, art, events, and then one focused on online actions, viral videos, tumblers, and change.org type petitions. So I'm going to turn it over to, I would try to pronounce your name, yes, I'm so bad at pronunciation, Gaya, to talk about your work in the Netherlands, and then to Alicia to talk about your work in the Bahamas. Yep.
All right. Thank you. Leg or something. So, like I said, I'm from the Netherlands. So, that's you probably have heard of it. It's a tiny country in Europe, and because we're so tiny, we've always focused on trade and not conquering other countries. So we've been throughout history quite peaceful. We've always been very tolerant, because if you're not tolerant of other cultures, you can't trade with them. So we have a long history of. We were the first country to legalize gay marriage, for example. we just legalized since I can't remember. so we especially I think after the Second World War, which obviously we didn't start, we tried to stay neutral, but then the Nazis invaded us, and that happened pretty quickly. So after that, there was, through the entire Europe, but also definitely in the Netherlands, this sense of never again. So we upped our tolerance in that sense, and we even went as far as to say the florin that had been our currency since up until then. We said, we're going to have a new currency so that people will benefit it by collaborating with the Nazis are punished for it. So we really started with a clean slate. That's when we started the European Union. It was also for that, because again, when countries trade with each other, they're less likely to invade each other. That turns out that if you have a common currency, countries are more likely to spend more than they actually can pay back. But that's a whole different story. So against that background of tolerance, I started a civilian initiative to collect signatures for a law against catcalling, because it had always been there, and it started at an early age for me too, I think probably 13 or 14, but I always assumed that it would reduce, it would be less, because we were all still evolving to a more gender equal society. And then, about 20 years later, I noticed that it had actually gotten worse, it had gotten more frequent, and especially it had gotten more aggressive. And it started me thinking, and then I talked to some other people, and I talked to younger people too, and I noticed their apathy in it. They said, yeah, we like to say that we have gender equality in the Netherlands, but if we teach our young women to just suck it up and keep walking, that that's just not gender equality. If it's so ingrained that women cycle and take a longer route home because they don't want to go to that particular corner where the guys hang out, that's not free mobility. It's not gender equality. So that's why I started it up, also to find it, but also to raise awareness. And luckily, it did that because there was a lot of interest. It resonated with a lot of people. So I had a lot of interviews in all the papers and on some television shows and radio shows. So that's good. And we got the questions were always the same, right? So one of them is always, isn't it a compliment? So I already addressed that earlier. And I think we have, and I always said that, I think it's, there's not, we try to pretend that there's a gray area, right? Where it's like people have invented this other thing of gray rape. What the hell is that? You know, if a man comes up to me, and talking to me like I'm an actual human being, even when I'm not interested, that's not intimidating to me. If someone says, I mean, that's how I met my husband. He came up to me and said, I see you're holding a map of New York City. Is there anything I could tell you? Now, that's not intimidating. What I'm talking about is what I want to find. It's you walking by and people saying, hey, whore, you, how much are you? That's not flirtation. There's no woman who responds to that by saying, ooh, I like that approach. And they know that. They don't say it to reach you. They say it to intimidate you. So, and another question I got very often is, it's the Moroccans, isn't it? It's the Muslims. And that's something else that I wanted to come back to, because I noticed there's a reflex of white men who say, it's the immigrants, right? Okay, yeah, those guys are the problem, okay. And that's a very interesting point, because I noticed that from the left, which is typically more pro-feminism, not all the papers liked me so much from the left side, because they said there was too much of a risk that you stigmatize the Muslim immigrant men. And then there was the people from the right were a little bit too eager to talk about it. But then just to put the blame on the Moroccans. And I think that's a very interesting discussion that we shouldn't shy away from. And I think that you brought that up as well. There's also this aspect of race in it. And I think we need to have a discussion where you can say, I think in my experience, that there is a disproportional part of the men who do it with a Muslim background. But doesn't mean that only Muslims do it, and it certainly doesn't mean that all Muslims do it. But I do not want to have to silence myself just because some other guys can use it for their racist agenda. And that's something that we're still working on right now in the Netherlands, I think, to have that discussion be a little bit more nuanced. And I think it's not so much in the US maybe, but in Europe, again, especially after the Second World War, we're so afraid of racism, which is good, but it shouldn't be at the expense of feminism, of gender equality. And I do not want to have the choice between being called a whore or being called a racist. Thank you.
As I mentioned earlier, the Bahamas is a pretty small country made up of a lot of islands. Most of them are small, some of them are larger. But for the most part, they've been densely populated, and our population has really increased quite a bit over the last few decades, I would say. So my grandparents and my great-grandparents grew up in a very different Bahamas than I'm growing up in right now. But there are a lot of people in my generation and the generation before me that still wants to hold on to a lot of those things that no longer exist. And I talked about this a little bit in a blog post that I did for the Stop Street Harassment website, where we're sort of confusing the issues of having good manners and street harassment. So if someone comes up to me and says, hey, sometimes I might respond and sometimes I won't. And every time I talk about street harassment in a public place, particularly on talk radio, I get a lot of calls, particularly from men, who say, y'all women are just too rude. People are just saying hello to you, you need to respond. And they're missing out on some of the nuance there. And they're talking about, you know, my grandfather taught me that, you know, la 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 la, and when he was young, everybody would greet each other when they walked by. And really, in a lot of ways, the Bahamas is like that. When you walk into a doctor's office, you see three people there, you kind of say good morning, and the people there, either they say good morning or they might just say, you know, something that resembles a greeting. If you get on the bus, people generally will say good morning, good afternoon, that sort of thing. But when we're talking about a man saying that to a woman, and the woman not knowing where it's going to go, especially given her own experiences, we can't put the burden on them to respond. And really, what are you losing by saying good morning or good afternoon to a person when they don't answer? And that happens to me sometimes, and I just keep it moving. I don't care. You didn't ruin my day. But what it ruins is the effect that they want to have on you. They kind of want to be in, on some level, in control of you, and to force you to take a particular action. And if you deviate from that, it's a huge problem. And as Holly mentioned, we have to recognize that street harassment is on the spectrum of gender-based violence. It's not just this incident that could happen once or twice and that's it. Because at the end of the day, I feel like if you can treat me that way in a public place, I don't know what you would do to me two blocks down when there's a dark alley and no one's around. If you can do that to me in front of people or in broad daylight. So that's a big part of what I've been talking about in the Bahamas. And Hollaback is about a year and a half old now. And I had dedicated the first year to basically educating people about street harassment and talking about what it is. Because I felt like a lot of the activists and advocates in the Bahamas tend to talk about things on level 100 when the people might be on level 30 because they're not looking at these very nuanced things. They're not looking at the intersectionality that's there or the connection between street harassment and rape. And so we have to bring them up more gradually and not just dive in and say, well, if you're a street harasser, then you're a rapist. Like that's a little bit too much to introduce to a population that doesn't even know the definition. And starting Hollaback Bahamas was really my introduction to activism. And now I guess you could say I'm a full-blown women's rights activist, pushing for changes to our constitution to allow women to have the same citizenship rights as men, which we don't, and that's a whole different story. But it's really been a learning process and realizing that as cliche as it sounds, education really is the key. It is where we have to start. And we do have to be open to having these conversations with people who have different points of view and who may respond to us in ways that make us want to shut them down. And finding that balance between engaging people in conversation, but also not feeding the trolls and not kind of burning yourself out in the process. And I realized that very early on in responding to things on social media and people telling me, well, you know what, you just need to be raped and then you'll be fine. And so there are a lot of things to learn in your first year or so of activism, and I've learned them all pretty quickly, especially since I know that I live on an island that's 21/7, and if someone is really that motivated to cause me harm, they can probably do it. So I guess what I really want to leave you with is that activism is a process. And talking about street harassment is a process. And we have to sort of start at the beginning and guide people through and help them to understand what it is, what it looks like, and what kind of effect it has on us, the people who are experiencing it. And realizing that it's not cultural. There's one thing that I'm sick of hearing is that it's Bahamian culture, it's just the way that we are. And my question is, if it's Bahamian culture, why is it happening in the United States? Why is it happening in the Netherlands? Why is it happening in any other place? If it's about what I'm wearing, why is it happening in Yemen and in places where people are wearing full burqas? Please explain that to me. And when you throw these questions out to people, it forces them to think a little bit. Even if they don't admit it to you, they're going to have to rethink their position, but the way that you present it to them has to be fairly open and not adversarial. And it's very difficult to not respond in the same way that someone approaches you, but the work is greater than having that moment of satisfaction. So I think that we have to be a little bit thoughtful, be open to hearing the critique of other people and guiding them to our position, to where we are, and showing them with real life examples alongside data what the reality is.
thank you. And both of them have employed things like sidewalk chalking and viral videos and petitions too. So there's a lot of tactics that that people all over the world are using to address this. And they both talked about education as being important. And you know, street harassment is really socialized all over the world. Here in the US, it starts with nursery rhymes and kids' cartoons, and it's in a lot of the media we consume. So it takes a lot, it's gonna take a lot of effort to change the mentality around this. And one way to do that is by working with youth. So I'm so happy to have some of our local people who are working on street harassment here, and then also BC has an initiative that will be working with youth.
So SIS, they are high schoolers, and at that time they were anywhere between 9th grade and 12th grade, got together and decided to do a participatory action research project looking at street harassment. And what came out of that was a film called Hey Shorty. And it was inspired by another film on street harassment. And so they wanted to make their own film and look at it and how the context and what it looked like in Brooklyn, New York. And so they made the film, and at that time we were just looking at their personal experiences. So they were the people that were doing this work, they were out there, they interviewed their friends. And something that it's still a thing that they said is that street harassment for a lot of their peers was like a sport. Right, so it's like a thing that you play, and it's like who can get the most points and like at what corner. And people would, like, if you were to split up your friends from one block to another, like by the time you got to the next block, the same person would harass them. And so it was not a matter of like a compliment, but literally needing to collect all of these young women. And then after that came Hey Shorty the book, which focuses on sexual harassment in schools. And so our findings were it just wasn't happening in the street, but like literally the halls of their hallways looked very similar to the streets that they were walking down. And so we would have young people in classrooms being harassed in different ways. And so GGE responded in many ways. One was a poster campaign that said like street harassment is a crime, right? And letting people, young folks, be able to craft language, one, to understand what street harassment was, and then two, assert that they had a right not to be harassed. And there's some, we look back and like thinking about the issues with like, what does it mean to be a person of color and engage a police officer in New York City to say that you're being harassed? There's a whole bunch of complications with that. And whether or not the police are actually accountable to you and your body. And then moving forward, they led street harassment summits, which had the community come together and have an intergenerational conversation, which is very important because we had older people saying that it was almost a rite of passage, that like, you grow up, this happens, you know? And we didn't want that to happen anymore. So young people got together with their elders and had a conversation, and a lot of people spoke and put the issue on the map for us. And we continue that work up until now. I wanna talk about like one thing that oftentimes women are on the front lines of the conversation about street harassment. But Girls for Gender Equity did this thing called Bring Your Brother Day. And basically SIS brought their brothers, their homies, their friends that were male identified folks and had a conversation about street harassment and what it looks like. And the findings from those workshops showed that young men don't have access to public space either, right? Like, they have access to public space in those ways, but where can they be themselves? Like, there is no crafted space for them to be able to engage with women. They don't know how to, right? So they use, especially if you're a person of a marginalized group, you don't have access in the ways that other people may. And that oftentimes the conversation and looking at the nuances, the conversation and like some of the videos that may come out, look at how people of color are the harassers, but white men and white cisgender folks harass too, but in different spaces. So if we look at the workplace and like places like that, it's important to see the ways in which street harassment is crafted and the narrative is crafted in the US, and that's all the only thing I could talk about, or in Brooklyn, which I really could talk about, and then how it looks different in different places. So Bring Your Brother Day was a chance for young men to get to actually talk about why it was happening, that there was pressure to do it, that there was a lot of things connected to how they saw masculinity developing that was so connected to street harassment. So it even wasn't even just a matter of like infringing on a woman's body or making comments, but literally like as a rite of passage to becoming a man in a world that does not teach you what masculinity could look like. And so therefore the default is to attack or comment or be rude, and sometimes lead to physical violence on a young woman's body as a result of the absence of such lessons. And I think something that hasn't been lifted in what we're working with now, and like 10 years later, our lens has become more broad, is thinking about the ways in which gender non-conforming folks are harassed on a daily basis, how trans people are harassed on a daily basis, and that doesn't always get captured in the narrative when we talk about street harassment, how we have gender non-conforming people in our program and have had them, and they'll be harassed because there's a poster that says it, like, you know, my masculinity is not a threat to yours. Right? And so the ways in which I show up in the world do not threaten who you are, but people do feel that way and constantly will make comments about, like, if you had a man like me, you wouldn't dress like that, or you're not woman enough, or and really threats to their bodies and the ways that they show up. And so expanding the conversation around street harassment has been something that GGE has been committed to. And furthermore, what we're doing now is looking at the ways in which young people are policed, right? Not just sexual violence, but in schools, literally, and there's an example in the news recently, how young people are criminalized and policed for the way they show up, right? And so, like, it's beyond their gendered bodies, but the ways in which gender and race intersect can lead you into the hands of an officer because of who you are. And so that's where we're positioning our work to look at the full expansion, the expansive experiences of girls of color, specifically in Brooklyn, from street harassment to their experiences in the classroom, and how we can best position ourselves to help young women live truly self-determined lives.
I think I'm just going to take off from that wonderful talk he just gave. And like I said earlier, I just wanted people to understand that street harassment is about power. It's very much about who has got the power. And one of the reasons why, what some of the things that Gaya said, which is becoming very topical in Europe, is about street harassment and race. And I remember that we have the same discussion in the UK when there was a breaking news that a group of Pakistani men had been harassing white women, and this became something big in the news, and the narrative was always, oh, that is what the Indians and the Pakistanis, that's what they do, and it was not so much about what really they do, but the way that they view white women. But the narrative that was lost in that was the fact that a year before that, there was a breaking news of a huge sexual abuse within the UK, within the establishment of the UK, perpetrated all by white men. And nobody wants to talk about the fact that these white men were raping young and vulnerable girls, but we were able to concentrate on the fact that these Muslim men were harassing white men, white women. What am I trying to say is the fact that it's about power. And that's one of the reasons why, Guy, I'm going to a little bit disagree with you around the fact that we want to specialize the issue around the fact that it's a group of people and we don't want to talk about them. This is a problem for men. Let us talk about it as a problem for men. It doesn't matter where that man comes from. Whether that man is black, whether that man is white, whether that man is Asian, whether that man is Indian, whether that man is from Pakistan, whether that man is a Christian, whether that man is a Muslim, whether that man is an atheist, this is a problem. And the problem comes from the fact that, just like, very much like you said, the expression of what really is a man, you know, the masculinity, the expression of the macho masculinity, and which leads me to one of the projects that I'm doing in Nigeria. So I came out on national television in Nigeria in 2004, that was 11 years ago, and it became a very big thing in my country, and that was just few months after Facebook was launched, and there was no Twitter, so there was no way that anybody will actually know what one crazy boy was doing back in Nigeria then. But the interesting thing was that I was kind of like breaking barriers. And 11 years later, I started this foundation. And the whole idea of starting the foundation was for me to you know, stop being on the sideline and moaning about things and complaining about things. And just like taking action, basically. I just try want to correct things. And one of the key things that I'm trying to do through education is to set up a gender and sexuality library in Nigeria. The whole idea is the fact that I can complain about, and like I said, you know, the situation for LGBT people in Nigeria is not so much so about the awareness that we know that we're experiencing street harassment. It's very much about understanding of the fact that we're experiencing homophobia. But when those kind of things kind of happen within our own community, so within the lesbian community or within the gay community, and how then do we interpret that? And most times, because we don't know what we're going through, we don't have words for it, we just brush it under the carpet. And like, you know, like it has been said this tonight, it's on the spectrum of gender-based violence in a way. And I will go back to it, it's the person that has the power. Because if you don't have the power, you cannot harass somebody. It's predominantly because you know that you have power and that you can subdue somebody. So what I'm trying to do is to set up a library, kind of like an institute, where you know people can easily access books and they can read about things. And you'll be very shocked that we're seated here, we're talking about, you know, street harassment. It's 2015. If you go to Nigeria, a country of 170 million people, and you talk about street harassment, even for so many women, the understanding of it is still very vague. Most women don't know that what they are going through is street harassment. They have no words for it. And it's about creating our consciousness in the minds of people to know that you should not be subjected to things like this. This is not fair. This is not right. This should be challenged. But also, you know, it's an extremely religious country in a way that even when you go to the police station and you report it, it's likely that you get the police, you know, telling you that, oh, do you want to tell me you're not enjoying it? You know, can you imagine how many women have walked down the street and no man has told how beautiful they are? Somebody's telling you you're beautiful, you're not even happy. Just go away and go and look for something else to do. You know, and that can, in a way, discourage people from reporting such things. There are developments happening. That's this year alone, there has been over 20 cases of rape of children as young or somebody within the environment. This is coming up because more and more there's this consciousness amongst women to challenge not just street harassment, but to challenge also rape of young girls. And the idea of the library is that people can easily have access to information. They can question what they know. They can read up ideas, you know, having access to Holly's book, in a way, kind of put words into experience and kind of help put you in a position where you know what you're experiencing, but also know that you're not the only one that is experiencing it, but there are a lot of people that are experiencing those kind of things. This particular project in the startup stage, we're hoping that in the next few years, we will be able to actually push it forward. But I just want people to know that we're sitting here, we're talking about this being a disaster. I just want you to know in Africa, and I'm not doing scaremongering, it's indeed an epidemic. And it's something that we need, really, really need to push and start talking about.
Thank you, Holly, for inviting us. I always feel indebted to you because you were one of the first people who actually recognized the importance of teachers in this movement. My name is Ileana Jiménez, and I'm a high school teacher here in New York. I've been teaching for 19 years. And it's really, I'm indebted to Holly and Stop Street Harassment and to GGE, Girls for Gender Equity, for politicizing me to this issue. If it hadn't been for meeting Holly right before I left for Mexico, all of this was kind of happening at the same time. So in the fall of 2010, when Julissa Ferreira had this New York City Council hearing where activist groups like Girls for Gender Equity, Hollaback, Stop Street Harassment, were testifying and sharing stories about their own experiences of street harassment, I was asked to send students to that hearing. And this was really how I became kind of politicized to the issue. And I had invited Hollaback activists to come to my classroom, and this was kind of in the earlier kind of years of teaching this course on feminism that I teach to high school students. And they said, do you have any students who would like to testify and to share their stories? And one of our students, Grace Tobin, went, shared her story. She was then interviewed by CBS and a number of other outlets. And Grace came back, this was the fall of 2010. She came back and she blogged for our class blog, After the Third Power, about the experience of having shared her story in front of a room full of people she didn't know. And it was a story about public masturbation on the subway. And she realized, wow, this was my entry point to activism, school. If it hadn't been for this moment where I had asked activists to come into my classroom to share their work, who then invited my students to be a part of the change, the transformation, the action making, my students would not have learned the power of storytelling to make change. So she blogged about that, and that was a moment when I realized I could use my classroom as a space to make street harassment a much more visible topic at school. Because if I don't care about street harassment as a teacher, then that means I really don't care about the safety of my students coming to school and going back home. So when I hear StellaRose's story about getting into the cab on the way to school and that traumatizing moment that she's having in the cab with the man who's interrogating her, basically, and I love, not love, but I was so, I felt like that was so accurate of you, Holly, for saying that it's a form of pedophilia. I've never heard it said that way, but as soon as you said it, I said, yes, that's exactly what it is, which is that StellaRose is experiencing pedophilia on the way to school. So if I don't care about that as a teacher, I don't care about the safety of my students. Because that is a traumatizing moment. What's interesting about your story, StellaRose, is that you forgot about it kind of momentarily throughout the course of the day, and then when your mom asked you about it when you got home, it all came back, and the trauma of it came back, and the stories and the detail came out, and then you were able to report it. There was no, what devastates me about that story is that no one at school knew about it, right? So it's like that silence all day long, going to classes, even though she hadn't thought about it, it impacted her body and her mind in some way throughout the course of the day. So this is how I became politicized to this issue in terms of I need to care about street harassment because my students are experiencing it going to school, going back home. When Shana shared her story at the International Day of the Girl Assembly a couple of years ago or last year, and she reenacted this moment of harassment. And just this morning we talked about, I said, Shana, you don't have to share that particular story. You can share another story. And she said, well, it happens every day. Which one do I pick? So it's one of these things where every day I am repoliticized, which is that my students teach me about how this issue is pressing on their minds every single day. Tomorrow, Holly is coming to speak to my feminism class. And I really think this is an integral part of the course because of the fact that my students experience this every single day. And it is a kind of, my students experience it on an intersectional level. I've had gay, male, Latino students write about how they have been harassed on the street. White students, African-American students, queer students. For me, this is also connected to sexual harassment and bullying at school, which is that if they're experiencing something on the street, they're experiencing it at school as well. And I think oftentimes, bullying is actually a kind of band-aid word or a kind of safer word to say than racism or sexism or homophobia or transphobia that our students are actually experiencing every single day in the hallway. So for me, street harassment is then connected to the sexual harassment and the racism and the homophobia and transphobia that the kids are facing in the hallways. So it's all, unfortunately, the cycle of violence that young people are facing need to be at the forefront of what teachers are thinking about, in addition to and equal to the discipline or topic that they teach. Because if we're not caring about the safety of our students, our whatever discipline or topic we're teaching is not actually going to be learned. It's going to be a sidebar, right? It's going to be this like radio fuzz on the side while I'm thinking about the fact that I've been harassed on the cab or someone touching Shauna's leg as she's traveling with her father. So I'm just going to end with the fact that I'm so glad that Holly understands the importance of teachers in this movement. I'm so grateful to you for including me always in your conversations. And I want, if there are other educators in the room, I hope you also become politicized to this issue. If you know teachers, please share this book with them and Holly's other book as well, Stop Street Harassment. Because we really, it really is a school issue. It's an education issue. It's a safety issue. And it's an issue that is about our young people. And that's the most important thing. Thank you.
Thank you all so much. And I hope that it's clear that this is such a global problem, but the good news is that people all over are tackling it. And I personally am so especially grateful for the people working with youth, and I think all of us work with youth in some way or another, but it's just so essential. And I hope that all of you in the room, I mean, you're here because you care about this issue, so I'm sure you probably already are doing something, but if you need the rallying cry, I hope you can join campaigns in your area or at minimum share your story and speak out on this issue. So we are happy to take questions now from anyone in the audience.
Hi, my name is Julia. I have a nonprofit here as well in New York working on street harassment and engaging men. So thank you all so much for the work that you're doing as well. So I have a question for Ileana in education. What kinds of education or curriculums exist already to bring respectful relationship education to young people? Because obviously, from the ages of 12, people are sharing stories about being harassed. So how do we bring the education to really into schools about respectful relationships and gender equality to really stop it at its root?
I often feel that my next career is going to be sex education. I'm an English teacher. So I teach literature, I teach books, I teach the books in this room. But I often feel like what I'm also doing as an English teacher is sex education in the form of humanities. I think sex educators have a much better answer for you, but I'll tell you what I do. When I teach my course on feminism, I deliberately and intentionally ask the students on the very first day to share stories about how they have received messages about gender. And I say, write a personal story, a narrative, about how you've learned messages about your assigned gender and the gender you identify with via school, home, friends, media, politics. And every single year, without fail, students will come in with a story that reflects not only the ways in which they've internalized these messages, but the ways in which they've internalized the messages in relation to other people. So in relation to their siblings. What they don't realize is that they're actually, by default, writing intersectional stories without even knowing that that's what I've asked them to do. But they wind up doing it because they realize they can't separate their cultural, racial, socioeconomic class, sometimes religious and political identities from the ways in which they've internalized gender. And then as we move through the course, there are different ways in which I've been able to kind of address gender-based violence. Boys take the class every single year. I've never not had boys in the class. So they will talk about toxic masculinity. And they will talk about the ways in which they have been relating to their parents, relating in their relationships, relating to their fathers, in like the cycle of toxic masculinity. So although I don't teach relationship curricula, because I'm not a sex educator, I do teach about toxic masculinity, gender-based violence, different ways in which we relate to each other. In other classes where I've taught like queer literature, for example, I've taught novels like Stone Butch Blues. And there are pretty explicit scenes in that novel where we talk about sexuality and we talk about intimacy and we talk about the different ways in which queerness and sexuality intersect in that novel. And I want them to see the ways in which we can talk about relationships via literature. So that's the way I do it. It's the texts themselves and the texts that the students themselves bring out of their personal experiences where we talk about relationships.
I just have something to add to that. So I agree with Ileana around sex education. And in New York City, at least public schools, since 2011, comprehensive sex education has been mandated, but that really doesn't mean anything because people aren't exactly doing it. But there is a mandate for sex education, which is supposed to include healthy relationships. In addition to that, there's layers of policy that are supposed to be, you know, followed in schools that include programming and curriculum around these things. So on the city level, we have Respect for All, which really comes out of helping young people understand and not discriminate against gender and sexuality expression presentation. And there's always a Respect for All day, in at least one day. And there are usually posters around schools that talk about that. And, you know, some, I call it like the gay friendly sticker, but like some guidance counselors have the rainbow on their door and it's like, hey, you can talk to me about gay stuff. But it's supposed to be one entry level, like one way in which schools address it. And then on the state level, there's DASA, the Dignity for All Students Act, which is supposed to address that on a state level, which is more comprehensive than Respect for All. And then, of course, on the federal level, we have Title IX. And Girls for Gender Equity, along with other organizations and coalition, really pushed for schools to uphold Title IX. And we're seeing that happen on college campuses, where one of the schools I go to is holding campuses accountable for their violations of Title IX. The biggest issue we faced in New York City was getting them to even list a Title IX coordinator so that students could report incidences of sexual violence or sexual abuse or sexual harassment. I think for the 1,600 schools in New York City, there is one Title IX coordinator that is listed on the website. So there's work.
There's another hand. Is there a hand right?
Brittany, you just talked about this a little bit, but I'm curious, we've talked a little bit about individual action and community and organizational action, but I'd like to hear a little bit more about what's going on in your individual areas at the city, state, and federal level in terms of policy change, and if you've heard of any actual physical design interventions to improve safety for women or LGBTQ individuals.
Sorry for being formal. What do you mean with design?
Physical changes to improve safety.
So
in public spaces.
Would that physical safety would be more police officers on the streets? That
well, perhaps, but I mean also architectural and urban planning related interventions.
Yeah, I can tell a little bit about the initiative in the Netherlands. We had, you have that here in America too, right? Civilian initiative, and you need 100,000 autographs. here in the US, and then we'll get to the federal level and it will be discussed on the agenda. We have the same thing, only we need 40,000, which is in relative terms more. So we got about half of that so far. So it hasn't been put on the agenda in that sense. But because there was so much talk about it, it did reach several politicians. So we're currently speaking to a member of parliament for a national law. We're discussing that. And we're talking with the two politicians in the two biggest cities, Rotterdam and Amsterdam. And they're interested in putting it at a city level. And that seems to be going pretty quickly. So that would be cool, because then you have the two biggest city in the country. And then after that, you know, it could be rolled out nationally, which is what we're hoping for. Yeah, thanks.
I think one of the things that is, that is working in the UK, where I live now, is within the police, each constabulary, which is like your state police, so that's what we have. So we have, like, London has the Metropolitan Police, for example, and you are expected to have a special unit that are dedicated to such issues. So on, like, the borough that I live in London, the police station there must have an LGBT liaison officer, in a way that, so if anything happens, there's a police officer that is well-trained to understand what you're saying when you talk about street harassment. So they don't have to ask you stupid questions because they don't understand what you're saying. And also there are police officers that are actually trained on the issue of, you know, sexual harassment of women. And funny enough, there was a big controversy in London recently, which Holly got involved in, and which was the leader of the opposition party, when he was contesting for the leader, he said that he said he might, because of the street harassment crisis in London, that he might introduce safe carriages for women only, though that became a big national issue. And I guess principally is because he's the one that is talking about it, and it's not really liked. And I remember we had a little bit of chat about it, and I'm kind of like indifferent towards that. So there are people that have this very structured opinion about the fact that it is bad. It is a bad thing that there's a crisis, and the best way that you think as a man you can solve that crisis is by creating a space for women and not taking on the situation. And there are people that said, well, we've done everything that we think we could, and this is not going away. Maybe we need to find a way to protect the women. That has not gone. There's a process of consultation that is going on in London now about how do we make the underground safer for men, for women. How do we make the, most especially the London buses at night? It's one of the most dreadful places to be, either as a gay person coming back from club on a Sunday morning, or as a woman. Most especially because of the economic power, most people that do night cleaning, mostly black, migrant, or Eastern Europeans. So these are people that are coming back from work very early in the morning when there are nobody on the buses, but people that can easily prey on them and harass them. So there are those structures that are in place. I wouldn't say they are very, very effective, but I think I'm happy that in a way they're there and people can make use of them even when they need them.
UN Women's Global Safe Cities Initiative is very focused on working at the local, national, international level. So I encourage you to check out the Global Safe Cities Initiative, and you can see what they've been doing, because some cities, they've been at it for 5 years and they have a lot of guides. ActionAid is another international group that's been doing on the ground work in a number of cities, and they have research and they do women in the city reports. They've done them for the last 3 years. So they think a lot about space as well. And so they utilize something that originated in Canada called the Women's Safety Audit. And this is when groups of people from diverse backgrounds with different insights
go and evaluate a couple of blocks in their neighborhood and look for signs of inclusion and, you know, is there graffiti? Are the lights working? How safe would I feel standing here by myself at night or during the day? And, you know, collectively answer those questions and then come up with ideas for what changes might, you know, come about. So the UN and ActionAid heavily use that and surveys to really evaluate the community and how can we make it safer. And there are at least a dozen countries that have women-only public transportation. And on the flip side, there's a growing number of cities that have just plain anti-harassment transit campaigns. So like ads telling people don't harass, information about how to report harassers and training of transit police to know how to better respond appropriately. So I think a lot of those are, you know, relatively new enough that I don't know how well they're working. And yeah, I personally am not for women only, because I don't feel like that's ultimately the solution. Like, we should have men only transit if we're going to do that, like put all the harassers together. But they can fight it out. But anyway, so there are you know, a growing number of initiatives, and so I do cover a lot of those in my book as well.
Thank you all very much. I have three questions. You can pick and choose. The first is for the students. As you talk about your experiences of harassment and develop your own initiatives and actions, how do you have these conversations with other men, young men? How do they come into the room? And I'd really like to hear from the students especially. The second would be, as this is a discussion on global street harassment, and the room, I believe there's mostly Americans, how do you see Americans participating in the individual actions you are taking and the initiatives you're leading or in other movements? What type of programming I work at a charter school, and what type of initiatives from your experiences need to be taken for public schools, charter schools, and private schools? And is there any chance of intersection between the different resources and communities there that action could be taken? So pick and choose, whichever you'd like to respond. Thank you.
Thank you. And then we'll probably take maybe one more question, and then we'll be here for individualized questions. So do either of you want to talk first? Yeah.
I haven't actually sat down with like any of my guy friends and talked about street harassment with them, but if it ever comes up, I think at least the guys in our school or the people that I'm friends with, they try to understand it the best way possible, but since most of them haven't experienced it, they can't really connect on a personal level, so it's hard for them to understand why that, I can't really explain, like, the guys that I've talked to, they think that it's like how we were talking about the like compliment, or okay, this summer I went, this is kind of off topic, but over the summer I went to Italy with a couple of my friends, and we've all obviously experienced street harassment, but when we were there all together, it was like a constant thing. Like, we've never felt more exploited by these men, so. And we had a conversation about it because it just, like, we didn't know how to react to it. And our first reaction was always kind of to just put our heads down or, like, smile or, like, weirdly try to make them feel better about it, even though what they were doing was so not okay, especially because we're younger. So, yeah, I don't know if that answered your question at all.
You're all good, don't worry.
Something I find interesting is that at our school we have these conversations a lot, but I still feel like I can't really talk to the boys about issues on gender. Not just about street harassment, but also like harassment in schools. There's a lot of touching from boys, and like my ex-boyfriend, when I would say like someone harassed me in the street, he would get mad at me. And so there's a lot of progress in our school, but it's still like the boys are a little behind on street harassment. They still don't really understand, and it's hard to not be able to talk to boys that I'm really close with about it. And I found that a lot.
I don't know if I can respond to that. But I, as my personal advice, do with it what you want. But I think for any boy that you engage with, I always tell, I'm married now, but I always told my boyfriends from the first date on, you cannot be my partner if you're not also my ally. So if a guy gets mad at you, that's victim blaming. That's not okay.
Yeah.
You know, he's supposed to be your partner. He's supposed to be supportive for you. And just because they don't experience it, doesn't mean that they can't listen to you and learn from you how it is. And if they're not interested in hearing that, then they're not worth talking to.
Exactly.
I think that's where the school piece could come in, which is that I'm a part of a movement to bring feminism to schools, and it's a national and global movement of teachers, activists, researchers, scholars who are working to break down those silos. So when I work alongside Holly, who is an activist on the ground, and who I also see as a researcher and a scholar, I see us working at those intersections and breaking down those silos. And I also work with women's and gender and queer studies professors, and I work with professors and academics in education, and I work with other activists on the ground, like Girls for Gender Equity, and I bring them into my classroom and I say, how can we create and break down these barriers and create something new in schools that allows us to have a different kind of learning that takes place in classrooms? So when I was asked earlier about relationship kind of curricula, to me, the way that I'm addressing it is through my own discipline. I'm not a sex educator, I don't have that training, but that doesn't mean I'm not obligated or feel an obligation to address these issues. Because if we're not addressing them, who will?